David, you can hear and see me okay, right?
I can hear and see you great. How's everybody?
Doing good. Hi, David. Hi,
Hi,
Caleb. Thanks
David.
for doing this.
Oh, it's my pleasure. I love doing this kind of stuff.
Yeah, this is awesome. I'm really excited to do
Fun.
a part two after like part one went an hour longer than I thought it would, and at 2 hours total, and I felt like there was still so much more we could have covered. So I'm excited to get the chance to do this.
Okay, where do we start?
Well, let's see. Matt Borek, are you around? He's gonna help today with exactly
Present.
last time. Awesome. Ah, that's great. Just kind of like keeping an eye on the chat. First off, I'll just say if you have contributions, this is a Q&A. This is super informal, like last time. Neither David nor I are like super hung up on tradition, and we're not lecturing today. We're really just interested in meeting and talking to ACs, wannabe ACs, people interested in cameras in general, and to just have discussions about topics that relate to all of us.
And have fun.
Yeah, exactly. That's the number one rule. So, yeah, I guess I'll quickly introduce myself and why I'm here, and then just a basic intro for you, David. I'm a Union First AC. I've lived in LA for about 3 years, but before that, I was in Boston working. When I moved out here, I started to kind of unexpectedly work in film as a niche. And in order to do that, a lot of the information that used to exist doesn't really exist anymore, and online it's really difficult to find resources on working with film. So, David was one of the people I reached out to who ended up being super welcoming, helpful, always offered a hand or advice when I needed it. And yeah, by film, I mean working in 16 and 35 millimeter film primarily, like actual perfs and emulsion, which is definitely it's about half of the work I do, but I also work a good amount in digital. So as we kind of discuss the nuances of film, there's also going to be a lot of people who maybe don't work a lot with film, and that's totally fine. We'll probably have a lot to discuss and to contribute either way. But yeah, the star of the show today is David Elkins, who began his career as a film loader and second worked his way up to basically, first AC camera operate on shows including Wonder Years, Star Trek: The Next Generation, many more. He's known for writing the Camera Assistance Manual, which is how a lot of you probably first heard his name, which is a book now in its seventh edition, just packed with information about working in the camera department at all levels. So, really glad to have you here today, David. And yeah, how have you been since since our first Q&A in March?
Great. Great. I had a great summer so far. It's not over yet. Doing
Right. I
things
know.
with family and friends and
Yeah.
just enjoying life. Enjoying being retired,
Oh, man.
which
Sometimes feel jealous of that, but yeah, that's great to hear. And you're doing okay with all the storms out there, hopefully. It's been a bit wild.
Yeah, we've had some issues in recent days with the tornadoes, hurricanes, all kinds of things that were threatening on the area, but we got lucky and we got a lot of heavy rain a couple of days ago, but nothing major for me. A few friends of mine had some water damage and things like that, but nobody got injured or anything like that, so
That's great.
that's a good thing.
Right, that's what matters. Yeah.
You can clean up the water and fix your house and buy new stuff, but you can't replace people. Those are the most important. So let me add to what Caitlin said. I was a member of Local 600 before that. It was 659 as an assistant for 32 years. I belonged to the local, first as an AC, then as an operator. I was also a member of the SOC. If you don't know what that means, it's the Society of Camera Operators. Worked in Hollywood for most of my career. Spent a lot of years also teaching. And when I retired recently, I actually retired from the University of North Carolina, where I taught for 22 years. It was a great run. It was a great career. I loved it. There is no other job that can be beat. I hope all of you are involved in the film industry in some way and enjoy it as much as I did and as I still do. You know, I love when I get to visit sets from some of my students. So, like I said, let's have some fun. There is no stupid question. So if it's on your mind, ask it. And if I don't know the answer, I'll try to find it. Maybe not tonight, but I'll get back to you in an email or text or something if I don't know the answer. So let's just have a good time.
Yeah, that sounds great. And we'll share contact info near the end. And I know all of us, including Matt Borak, who's helping out with kind of helping running the Zoom today, is always super excited to hear from people. I know David is the same, and I'm pretty accessible as well. So yeah, a bunch of people, the city is super busy right now. So a bunch of people who I know wanted to be here but couldn't be. So I have a list of questions just like last time that we can start off with to kind of kick off the discussion, but we can have questions posted down in the chat, as well as if you have a question, I'll just ask you to raise your hand, which is a function under the reactions bar at the bottom of the screen. So just click raise hand if you have a question and just keep it up there until we get to you. We should be able to get to all the questions today. So to kick us off, I have a question a little bit about kind of your origin story, David. So for those of you who weren't here at the first Q&A, David, you didn't start off in the camera department, did you? I heard that your first feature, you actually worked in craft services. But it's not called
yes.
The Accounting Assistance Manual, so we know something happened along the way.
No, I went to film school in Los Angeles, a small school called Columbia College Hollywood, and got my degree with a concentration in cinematography. I always knew I wanted to do something with the camera department. And any of the student films that I worked on, I was either the AC or the operator. So I knew that was my passion, my niche, where I wanted to go. And when I graduated, most of my class had gotten a job on a lower than low budget feature. And the only position that was available by the time I hooked up with the production manager was craft services. So I was buying sodas and juice and fruit and vegetables and crackers and cheese and cookies and all the fun crap that we like to have at craft services. And I was doing that. But any chance I got, I went onto the set to see what the camera department was doing and watch them. And one afternoon, I heard the DP talking to the production manager that they were going to do some second unit shooting in on the weekend, and that one of the camera assistants, the one loading the film, was not available. And I saw the opportunity to stick my nose into things and go, hey, I know how to do that. And the production manager, who had been a classmate of mine at film school, had the nerve to say, well, you've only worked in 16 millimeter, this is 35. And I looked at him and I said, the only difference is the film is bigger and the equipment's heavier. The process is the same. What I have to do, you know. And so the DP looked at me and said, okay, you got it. So I went out for a weekend out into the desert outside of LA. We blew up an airplane. I loaded film into magazines. I guess I did a pretty good job, because about a month later, the DP hired me as the full-time second AC on the next feature he did. And that was the end of my career as craft services and the start of my career as a camera assistant.
So. Wow, just as fast as that. Did you find that like it was pretty easy to transition once you started film loading? Did you start getting offers for second ACing, and then once you were second ACing, the first AC gig started coming? It was kind of smooth transition.
I was, most of what I did when I first started was, I guess now they call it film loader, and then there's a separate second AC. Back then in the early 80s, it was all one job. The film loader and the second AC were the same person. And So there wasn't really a transition for me. I did it, and I made a concentrated decision that I wanted to do it for at least 2 years. I wanted to work my way up the ladder, as they say, to do each job until I got to where I wanted to be. And I knew very early that I wanted to become a camera operator. So, pretty much 2 years and a few weeks maybe went by, and I finally made that cutoff and said, okay, I'm no longer taking second AC jobs. I'm going to be a first AC and full focus. But while I was seconding, I got the opportunity on a number of shows. They would bring in a second camera, and they'd always put me on the second camera with the widest lens and the best f-stop because they knew I couldn't screw it up. You know, just to get some practice on the knob and turning and watching actors and everything.
Yeah.
And that's how I started to get practice pulling focus. And the more I did it, the more they gave me a few more complicated shots until I got my first feature, which was a horror film called Waxwork. And I was the key first on that. And then it just went from there again. You know, as you all know, if you're all working in a business, it's about, you know, you get on a show, you meet some people, then you get on another show and you meet some more people, and they give you a reference or a call, and it just grows. And that's how it went for me. It just grew from that first job as craft services up till basically until I retired from working on set. There were people that I worked with later on in my career that I had known since the very beginning. It's just the way it worked out. So the
Yeah.
transition wasn't hard, I would say.
Yeah, that's interesting. It sounds like you weren't in a rush either. It wasn't like you were
No.
immediately on set, like, I only want cushy operator jobs. You were committed to kind of doing the work and, you know, willing to move up, but also not trying to do it too soon. I see
Yeah.
a couple of hands up. McKay, I saw yours first, so go ahead.
Oh, hey there.
Hey.
It's really cool and interesting to hear the attitude of like, no, I'm just gonna be satisfied and work on work at this level for a long time and really get to know it. The other thing that made me laugh is when you mentioned your first job film loading, you said, I guess I did a good job, which is something that I've definitely experienced a lot, where you're like, you know, you are touching the film, it's all in your hands. And I like to, whenever I'm done and I'm handing the film off to the producer or whatever, I like to say, here's the movie. But it's funny because you don't know, like, you don't know if you did a good job or a bad job unless somebody sends you an email that says, like, oh, this is, which luckily I've never had. But you're like, I guess it's good. I guess it's good. You know, like, I didn't get a bad. So I don't know. I found it pretty funny. But,
Well, I knew when I went to dailies the next day, if there was an image on the screen, I must have done it right.
Right. Yeah, no
No.
kidding. But my question was,
Oh, I was just gonna say, I've heard of focus pullers after like a really harrowing, difficult shot, like coming into the lab super early the next day to just be the first one to watch it, just to make sure it looked fine. And you know, that feeling when it is pretty hard to beat.
yeah.
That's pretty funny. Real quick, I did want to ask, it's cool to hear you say that the transition was pretty easy, but I was wondering if you had to work, you know, when you were in those moments of, well, I guess specifically from the transition from second AC to first, if you had to work jobs that were kind of, if you had to work like bad jobs, like ones that didn't pay as much, or kind of have to like, maybe the standards weren't as high in order to
Film
gain.
jobs? You're talking of film jobs. Okay. I have very low standards. So, not really, but I'm of the mindset that, and people would always ask me, well, what kind of jobs do you like? Do you like features? Do you like music videos? Do you like commercials? And my standard
smartass answer was always, I like to work. So if a job came up and I didn't have anything going on and it seemed worthwhile, and if, especially if I knew the DP, if I knew the DP, it was somebody I liked working with, I would take a lower rate for that job, just because what am I going to do, sit home and wait for the phone to ring, or be out on set doing something? And I always would rather be on set. Now, yes, there were times when I got called for a job. I got called for a job one time. I don't know where this person got my name, but they got your name, and we'd like to hire you as an assistant. But we'd like to interview you first. And I said, okay, fine. You know, I was not opposed to that. You know, early in my career, I understood. And the guy said, I said, where's your office? He said, just on the corner of 6th and Grand Street, let's just say. And I said, okay, and what's your office number? He says, no, we'll meet you on the corner of 6th and Grand Street. And that told me right then and there that there was something weird about the job. And I just very politely said, thank you very much. I'm not available, hung up the phone. Mm-hmm. There were only a few, I would say, a handful of jobs that I actually took that I wish I hadn't. But my other work ethic, my other policy is, if I take a job, I do not leave it. Mm-hmm. I have made a commitment to you. I will stay no matter how painful it is.
Yeah.
And nothing was so horribly painful. It's just, you know, uncomfortable. It was like, is it over yet? You know, type of thing. But only a few, really.
Well, that's good to know. Thank you. Thank you, David.
Yeah.
The answer. I appreciate it.
Yeah. Sonny, I see your hand up too. What question do you have?
I actually had to take a step back from film because I got into an accident, and I had to just take the time out to recover and recuperate and get ready to, you know, get back in. So how would you recommend that I get back into all that?
How long have you been out of it?
About roughly 7 years.
Oh, wow. That's probably going to be tough, as you've probably already seen. One thing I would do is start calling or trying to contact some of the people that I worked with previously when I wasn't active in the business, and see what they're doing. See if they can either hire you for something or refer you. But I would always start with the contacts that you had before you had your accident. Those are the best. Also, do you live in LA now, or are you?
No, I'm in the Bay Area.
You're in the Bay Area. I don't know what rental houses are up there, but try to get into some of the camera rental houses and see what the projects are going on. Talk to the ACs that are prepping. Maybe there'll be some DPs in there, and just basically you're starting over again.
Yeah.
You know, after 7 years, it's essentially starting over again. But the one thing I would do is start with the people that you worked with at the beginning, and go from there. And I wish you luck.
Thank you.
Yeah, another really great change in the industry that I've seen is just that the online networking is a really great way to be effective too. So as overwhelming as it might seem to like cultivate an Instagram page and really like market yourself, it can also be as chill as just kind of being on Facebook groups for the region where you want to work. Like often jobs get posted. Sometimes they're kind of bottom of the barrel, like really, really low paid. But I was able to initially, when I moved out to LA, not knowing anybody, really kind of start my career out here kind of fresh just by being on those groups, meeting some people, got on a couple commercials that were staffing up last minute, but very, you know, reasonable rates. So definitely like look into what groups exist for your area and kind of, because you have the skills, or at least a lot of the skills that you built before. Mm-hmm. So in theory, you should be able to, all you really need is a couple chances to start working again.
Yeah, I'm part of a couple of groups up here. They kind of send out, you'll see posts almost every day for people who are trying to fill up last minute positions, or usually it's like PA positions that I've been basically applying for, trying to see if I can just get my foot in the door on that production, and then eventually like kind of start talking to who's there, and then slowly try and get back into the like camera niche of everything.
Yeah, it sounds like you're taking all the right steps. So good luck with that. Sounds like you're well on your way.
Thank you.
Yeah. Bethany, what you got?
Hi, guys. Caitlin, David, first of all, thank you for putting this on. It's awesome. Glad to be here. So, David, kind of what you mentioned before about that you just like to work and you would kind of take any job, that's sort of where I've found myself, to the point that now I like, sometimes I first, sometimes I second, a lot of times I key grip. I actually have a job coming up that I'm gaffing, which is super cool. I get to, you know, work with all kinds of people and make connections. But I guess, when did you kind of feel, I know you said you set up like a 2-year marker for yourself. At what point is it like, do you kind of know that you have to step back and be like, okay, I am this, I'm marketing myself as this, and I want my, you know, career longevity to be as this specific position?
So at what point did I know I wanted to move up from second to first?
That, and just kind of making that decision of like, because I love doing so many different things, but I know ultimately I want to join Local 600, and you know, I want my career to be in the camera department. So I guess at what point do you kind of know that it's time to step back and be like, okay, I need to stop taking jobs as these other things and really market myself as one thing?
When it's not fun anymore for me. Second AC, you know, having my hands in a changing bag, because when I started out, when I was working as a second, Patty Harrison had not invented the changing tent yet. So I never had any kind of changing tent like many ACs, loaders have had in recent years. So I was stuck with a changing bag where the top half of it was resting on my arms as I'm trying to load the 1,000-foot roll of film into a 35-millimeter magazine. And it just got old after a while. It just got, you know, okay, I can do this, pardon the pun, I could do this with my eyes closed. Everything just started falling into place. I started getting more opportunities as a second to bump up to first on the second camera, as I mentioned earlier. And I even got a chance to do a couple of really small projects as the first AC for free, which I did. That's the one thing, don't be afraid to work for no money at first, or even later on in your career. Again, it all goes back to who's the DP. There's a couple of DPs that to this day, if they called me and they said, I've got this job, I'm helping out a friend of mine, there's no money right now, but, you know, I would say, yeah, sure, where do you want me, when do you want me? Because there's so much fun to work with. So everybody's gonna be different. Like I said, for me, it was just when it felt right. The job I was leaving, so to speak, was just getting old and boring, and I needed a change. I needed that challenge of pulling focus without a monitor. I never used a monitor. I know we're gonna get into that discussion at some point tonight, but everything I did was pulling focus by eye and measurement, and just to nail that one shot. That's got, you know, I had one shot in my career that had 17 focus marks in one take. And when you get that and you nail it and it opens the movie, it's the opening scene of the film,
there's nothing like the feeling. So you have to know what is right for you. There's no definitive answer that's going to fit every single person. I hope that helps.
Yeah, no, that's great. I mean, it's nice to have that said from someone who's had a long career, because a lot of times it's me just questioning myself of like, am I hindering my career by taking on too many things?
The one thing that can happen to anybody is you can get pigeonholed. You can get pigeonholed and go, I'm not going to move you up to first because you're such a good second. Or I'm not going to move you up to operator because you're such a good first. I don't want to lose you as my first AC. What am I going to do? You know, and that happens to people sometimes, and they just have to make that cut and say, I'm a first AC now, I'm an operator now, or I'm a DP now. You know, and that's always the hardest part, because the people that you've been working with, especially if you've got one or two DPs that are constantly hiring you, it's because you're good at what you do. They like working with you. You have a great relationship, the rapport between you. They don't want to lose that. And then you get pigeonholed and you'll never get out of that hole. Mm-hmm. So.
That makes sense. There was a question kind of relating to that submitted by someone who's working today. Brandon Eastman had a question kind of pertaining to career first ACs. He was wondering, when working towards being a career first, do you think it's better to prioritize a couple relationships with DPs or kind of spread the net wide, work on your skills, your networking, your general reputation?
Well, if you can get in tight with a couple of DPs that you know you're going to always work with, like I had one DP especially named Randy Sellers, who when I was in LA, you know, I was his only call, and we worked together on probably 20 different projects. So again, it's going to go back to what I often say for a lot of these questions is it's up to the individual. What is going to work with them? What has been their pattern through their career? Have they gone from one DP to another? Or have they done a few jobs with the same person and then jumped to another person, then gone back to that first person? You know, it's going to be dependent on a lot of variables. But
yeah, that makes total sense. I think
career first, you know, it's great. I know a lot of guys that are career first. I know a lot of guys that are career seconds that are old guys like me, and they've been a second AC their entire life. And they love it, and they're good at it, and they constantly work. You know,
yeah.
So some people can, you know, enter the business by going to film school like I did. Some people just enter the business, say, I'm going to be in the film industry. Some have connections, family, whatever it may be. Some will climb the ladder like I did. I have a good friend who went to Columbia College with me, and he started out as a first AC. And now he's a DP on network television shows. He never did the ladder thing. He didn't need to. So everybody's going to be different. But what works for you?
Yeah, that makes total sense. I think it depends too what kind of world you exist in. Like if you're for a while I've been a lot of commercials, and in that way you end up dealing with DPs. A lot are flying into LA from New York. They've never worked with anyone in LA. You know, kind of meet a lot of new people. And then I do have DPs who tend to call me first for things. You know, a couple people who are kind of I think of as go-tos, and I'd always accept a job with them. Both are kind of nice because it's fun to work with new people, but it's also good to have someone who you're kind of confident working with. Exactly. Did you have any traits or qualities you looked out for in DPs you worked for repeatedly, or even like first ACs you worked under as a second, that made you just like super confident accepting work with them?
The biggest thing is, can I get along with them? You know,
important.
That's the most important.
Like when I get a call for a recommendation from a DP or from a first AC for recommend somebody for a job, usually the first question is, will they have a good attitude? Will I enjoy working with them? It's not going to be, do they know how to pull focus? Or do they know how to load a magazine? That's, believe it or not, secondary. If you can get along with someone for 12, 14, 16 hours a day, 6 days a week, you know, you've all been there, hopefully. That's the important thing. You know, with a DP, I hate DPs that yell off. Every single sound out of their mouth is yelling. I can't see that. Why is it necessary? You know. Also, I make it a point to always say thank you to the crew working below me at the end of the day. Those two words can go a long way. You know, and worked hard. Like I said, 12, 14, 16 hours. You go home at the end of the day and go, yeah. He said, thank you. I must have done a good job. Yeah. All right. Go back tomorrow and do even better. DPs that notice what you do, DPs that are not especially DPs, not trying to tell me how to do my job.
Yeah.
Even if they came up through the ranks, all right? If you hired me to pull focus and to maintain the camera and the camera department, then please let me do the job you hired me for. If you're going to constantly tell me what to do and micromanage me, then why am I there? You know, so there's
definitely, yeah, it's like our job as first ACs, second ACs is to take off that stress from the DP's plate. So if, you know, it's in everybody's benefit for the trust to be there so that, you know, that worry can just be taken care of by the ACs. Yeah. A bit of a pivot, but you mentioned like long hours, which I knew would eventually come up, but it's especially a big topic right now because of the union negotiations, which if people aren't aware of it, there's a, you know, big contract talks with the studios about either increasing or cutting down the average workday and also turnaround times, weekend rest periods. And it's a bit of a hot button right now. I put a poll up just now that's asking what the average workday is, and already 15 hours is the most common answer to how long you spend on set from the time you leave your house to the time you get back, which is kind of crazy. We're kind of used to that at this point, but it's also a little bit insane. So I wondered from your perspective, has film work always been running along the schedule, or is this just a recent development that nobody sleeps?
I had days in my career that ran from my shortest work day was 8 hours.
Nice.
And that was, believe it or not, that was one day on Star Trek. Huh. We finished everything we needed to do in 8 hours. And I was in my car going home at 4 p.m. and it was like, wow, I'm on vacation. It was great. My longest work day, and I use the word day, but my longest work day was 32 hours.
Oof. That's
32
crazy.
32 hours straight. So that was at the very beginning of my career. I was a second AC on a very horrible low-budget feature film. And I was not being paid, but it was one of those things that I did it to get a credit for my resume, because it was literally at the beginning of my career where I didn't have anything to show people yet that I could do the job. So most of my, I would say I averaged
12 to 16 hours, more in the 12 hour range, especially on TV and especially on the Wonder Years. If you're familiar with the Wonder Years, there's a lot of kids and strict SAG rules for child actors. So we never went past 12 hours with those kids. And even with the adult actors, we could, you know, schedule the kids different from the adults. We still had pretty much 12-hour days because SAG rules insist on 12-hour days.
Right.
And, you know, the productions don't want to pay the enormous amount of overtime to the actors. So, but there were some times, I mean, I did a music video once for Cypress Hill. Yeah, that was fun. And we were shooting in Malibu, and it got to be 8 hours past call time, and we still hadn't been given a meal. So I went up to the production manager, who was on set, and I said, you know, well, when are we going to have lunch? And he said, oh, yeah, I've got a bunch of pizzas in the trailer. We're just waiting for you to finish these shots. And I looked at him very calmly, and I looked at my watch, and I said, do you know right now you're in violation of federal law? And within 5 minutes, he called lunch. You know, things like that. But
yeah.
If it started to get too long, many people on the crew would start to complain. And then on a few occasions, they cut the day short. Not short, but, you know,
yeah,
it was in our 14th hour and they'd say, okay, go home. Right. But
yeah, it is definitely something I've seen. I think a lot of us have seen that speaking up does work. Especially if it's not just one person, even if it is just one person at first, sometimes that's all that it takes.
The problem is people are afraid to lose their job these days.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
To say
oh,
something,
totally.
You know, but is it worth your life? You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
Sarah Jones, she had a weird feeling the night before. She even said it to her father on the telephone, and something didn't feel right about that production. And the next day she was dead.
Right.
So, you know, I'm a firm believer of, I've spoken up more than once, pulling focus with the actors with submachine guns, they had blanks, but I've been hit by the wadding from a blank and it hurts and it burns. And they were shooting, they were about 6 feet from the camera lens, and there was no plexiglass protection between them and the camera crew. And I walked away and I said, I'm not doing the shot, it's not safe.
Right.
And after the director finished screaming and yelling, the DP and he had a conversation, and they finally, you know, set up the shot differently with a longer lens, and he got what he wanted and nobody got hurt.
Yeah, there's usually a way to get pretty much the same shot with just, you know, a couple additional safety steps that would make it industry standard. You know, it's never crazy complicated to have a safety meeting. If you have an armor, like, you know, they know how to do their jobs. It's just shocking to me how often the final step, which is just communication and actually, you know, putting people in the right places, it just gets forgotten. It's scary, yeah. Honestly. Yeah, it's crazy. I mean, I've not had a super long career yet. I'm on the younger side and I've already had bad experiences with guns, trains, motorcycles, crazy long hours. Like, I think all of us kind of have experiences like that. I just had a pull up and all the different categories I could think of, someone's experienced already. I'm sharing that now. But yeah, that's why I'm really interested to hear with this round of negotiations and potential strike with when the union's involved, that maybe finally there's going to be some change and some progress in that area. Because long hours are just, you know, they don't make sense in the long run. You're not going to get good work. And it's just super, super dangerous.
Yeah, people start to get tired. And
yeah.
They're going to make mistakes. You know, that's
it's human nature. It's a human body.
Yeah.
It only takes so much.
Yeah, it's funny to me that your shortest day, which was 8 hours and felt like a vacation, that's pretty much what a normal person would work in an average work day. Like, but to us, we're conditioned to be on set for 16 hours sometimes, and so 8 hours feels like nothing, which is not a great place to be when you think about it. Yeah.
Yeah. Trying to think of some other... it'll come to me. Let's continue on.
Yeah, for sure. We've got plenty of questions too. Sunny, you've had your hand up for a bit.
Yeah, so I had a question in regards to like choosing a career position. So my friend who basically taught me everything I know about being a camera assistant is in the local 600, and she said, make sure that when you're trying to get onto a project, try and be the second AC, because when you get your call sheet, and once you accumulate the call sheets, depending on if it's a union, non-union project, that will allow you to get into the union and then be able to take jobs higher than the second AC position versus like going downwards. So is it better to get into the union, or is it better to just stay non-union?
Again, I hate to keep using the same example or the same response, but it depends on the individual. I have many colleagues and friends in the union. I also have many who spent their entire career, 30 plus years, non-union, and they work constantly. So it's up to the individual. If you know a lot of union camera people that you can get hired by, and you feel that it's going to help you, then yes. And that's why I joined, because I knew the DP from Star Trek before he worked on Star Trek, before any of that stuff. And he was doing some low budget independent films. And he said to me one day, he says, "You get in union, I will hire you on something. I don't know yet, but," and I said, "Okay." And I got in the union and I got hired to pull focus on Star Trek The Next Generation. That was actually my second union job, because at the time I joined, there were two unions in the Hollywood. So the question of should I join or shouldn't I join, only you can answer that. Only you can decide, is it gonna help me in my career? Now, you can join and pay the initiation fee and the quarterly dues, and if it's not helping you, you can always leave. You can always, retire from the union. Not retire, because you have to be a certain age and certain number of years, but you can take what's called an honorable withdrawal, and just continue to work non-union. It's going to be up to you. You do understand that when you join a union, you have to declare a classification. And you can only work in that classification until you move up or go backwards. So you have to declare, I'm going to be a film loader, or I'm going to be an AC, or I'm going to be an operator. And if you're a union operator, you cannot work on union shows in another capacity unless there's special circumstances.
Yeah, I'm looking to get into the union as an AC, and then... once I work in the industry a little bit longer, for a certain number of years, eventually try and do like my own projects and become a DP.
Okay.
Because DP is my end goal. I want to be known as, or like, I want to end my career as a DP, but I, from what she said, the best thing to do right now for me, because she taught me everything I know, she said, just get into the union as an AC.
So I have some feedback about just ACing, because I think that's what a lot of us are kind of focused on right now, so to speak. Is based on the poll results I just had, I was curious how many union members versus non, a few, you know, we have a good amount of union folks, but also some people who are looking at it as an option right now. To join the union, it takes a lot of work and a lot of time. So you either need 30 days of union work, which that equals union connections, unless you're lucky enough to be on a show that flips. I'm not going to break down the whole process because it's boring and it takes a long time. But yeah, so you can either do 30 days of union work, or you can do what I did, what a lot of people who I know are doing, which is 100 days of non-union work. But that has to be stuff that's either broadcast on TV or screens in theaters or wins at festivals. It has to be like bougie, pretentious stuff. Okay. So you're not going to be able to just join the union and then work on being an experienced AC. But the good news is you can kind of do both at once, because in order to join the union, you need days of experience. Mm-hmm. So if you're passionate about being an AC, you basically don't have to do anything different. You just have to take as many jobs as you can, keep track of the checks that you're getting paid, and when and if you decide you want to join, all you really need in addition to your pay stubs or checks is a letter from each producer you worked for, which is a process to get, especially in LA where no one can respond to an email for the life of them, but it's possible, and it's really not that much of an extra step. You don't have to be doing anything different. You can just be working on yourself as an AC, working on your skills. And if you decide, you know, I basically decided to join once I started having to turn down union job offers. So I would start meeting people on set who were union. They would ask me to kind of join a commercial or maybe day play on a show that was union. And since I wasn't union yet, I couldn't say yes. So at that point, I decided to get all my days together and join.
Yeah, and that's basically, I got contacted by two different people who were filming out in Sacramento, and both projects were union projects, but of course, I had to tell them, like, I'm not a union member, so I couldn't work them.
And just do your best to, we all kind of go through the heartbreak of turning down jobs all the time that aren't a good fit. So, you just got to figure out what's right for you and what's a good fit. I might go ahead and turn it to a couple other folks if other folks have questions in the Zoom, but I also have some questions from those who couldn't be here with us today that I'll go to. All right, so this one is from Emerson Duggan, and he wanted to hear, David, your perspective and any other ACs who kind of focus on pulling off distance as opposed to relying on the monitor. I know this can be a hot topic, but he basically wants to hear advice on how to start building those skills of pulling off of distance.
Okay, well, that was the only option I had. When I first started, we didn't have video assist when I first started. So you either had to measure and know your distance or have soft shots. But there's a lot of tricks. There is a lot of tricks that you can use. One of the most, in some cases, well-known, know the distance between your outstretched arms from fingertip to fingertip. It's usually approximately the same as your height. So, you know, I'm 6'1", so I can go up to the front of the camera and line up one finger with the film plane and, okay, well, all right, that actor's about 6 feet away, and I don't even have to pull a tape measure. You're in a building, a home or a business that has tile on the floor. I mean, how wide are those tiles? Are they 12 inches wide? Are they 9 inches wide? 15 inches? So that, as the actor moves, if you can quickly add or multiply, you know that they're, you know, 18 feet, 6 inches away or whatever it may be. Know outside on a sidewalk, the distance between the cracks, not the cracks, but the dividing lines in the sidewalk where the cement is poured.
You know, that's usually a set distance. Measure, when I worked on a standing set, like the Wonder Years, the interior of the family home, a lot of it took place in the home that the people lived in. The interior of the family home was a set built on a stage in Culver City. So I had measurements, length, width, and diagonal of every room on that set. So if I was in a hurry and we had to get the shot because the kid actors had to go home, we would just get the shot. I wouldn't measure. So just practice guessing distances, all right?
They have, oh, go ahead, go ahead.
When you're getting ready to pull that tape measure from the camera to the actor, before you walk out there, just take a quick look and guess the distance and then pull the tape measure out and see how close you are. When I was starting out, a friend of mine and I would set up his 35 millimeter still camera. We'd go out in his house, in my house, we'd go out to a location and he would just say, okay, how far is it to that fence post? And I'd guess, and he'd focus the lens and then we'd look at the lens to see if I was close in distances. And the more you do that, the better you get. I can't tell you the number of shots I've had where the director of the DP said to me, hey, we're running out of time, the sun's going down, can you pull this without any marks? Which means I didn't check focus beforehand. I just, sure, go ahead. And the better you get at guessing distances, the more work you're gonna get.
So I initially learned to pull off of a monitor, which is different from you. It's like, I kind of feel like I worked in reverse. And a couple things that I found really helpful. One, they have depth of field calculator apps now. Like there's an app for everything. And one, you just plug in, you know, the lens you're on, how far away the subject is, some info on the sensor or the film plane. And if based on the rehearsal, it looks like I have 10 feet of depth of field, meaning I could be off in my estimation by as much as 10 feet. That's like a great excuse and like confidence to be able to turn the monitor off. Because if I know that I'm not going to be wrong by 10 feet, then it's kind of the security to know that that'll be, you know, a great chance to practice pulling without looking at the monitor. So that's what I did a lot of, as well as just measuring, just like you're saying, measuring all the distances. One that I would add is measuring from the film plane to the front of the mat box, for if, especially yes. if there's a like yes. if the lenses are the same size or if there's one certain 12-to-1 we're rocking for a lot of the shoot. Because like it can be like kind of deceptive if a character is 3 feet away but the lens is 2 feet long. Like that can kind of trick your brain. And so having mm-hmm. an idea that, okay, it's 18 inches, double that distance, so they're probably 3 feet away.
Yeah.
That was a really great kind of mental math shortcut for me that got me, especially estimating those short distances faster. Yeah. Yeah.
That's perfect. And Matt just posted in the chat, the best app that I think is out there is PCAM by David Eubanks.
Oh yeah, that is a really good one.
That is awesome.
Yeah.
So I've used it a lot, I'll share a quick story.
Yeah.
I was always saying this to my students when I was teaching. One day we had a Panavision camera donated to the school for a demonstration, and I was doing a demonstration, and one of my smart alecky kid students looked at me and said, hey, Dave, how far away am I? And I just stood there and I went, 27 feet, 3 inches. And we pulled the tape measure and I was dead on. 27 feet, 3 inches. And he never asked me that question again. It was funny. I just don't understand it. But you get used to guessing distances and knowing things. You know, but points in the room that you're in, shrubs and signposts and fence posts and things outside, you've got so much reference material at your fingertips that you don't need to know exactly how far the actor is, especially, as Caitlin said, if you've got depth of field where you've got like miles of room for error, then you don't have to worry. It's when you've got this much depth of field. I've had shots where I had a quarter of an inch. a quarter of an inch of depth of field. The actor just goes forward. If the actor sneezes, they go out of focus. So just if you know what your depth of field is, then you can feel more confident pulling without a monitor.
This is a question relating to that, and I don't want to get too deep into film-specific questions, just keeping in mind that there are some people who mainly do digital. But what was the etiquette like for hogging the viewfinder? Like, say you're doing a diopter shot and you don't have marks, or if you want to grab a quick mark before a shot, was that considered rude to ask the operator, hey, could I peek in this real quick? Okay, yeah, my sense is that more people would just come up and look in the viewfinder. Ask about that.
As the first AC, my first day on set, if it was with a new operator, I would always say, if I have to grab a quick eye focus, is it all right? Or do you want to do it? And sometimes they would do it. They would just back to focus knob and tell me where it is, and I'd mark it on the disc or on the lens.
That's nice.
I'd get it worked out ahead of time. But usually we had a protocol that only certain people could look through the eyepiece. And usually it was the DP, the operator, the first AC, the director, and maybe makeup and hair. But sure. Usually it was those four key people that I mentioned. Mm-hmm. Anybody else want to look at the shot? They could either go to the monitor when we did have a monitor. And even with the advent of VideoTap and monitors, I never used a monitor for focus.
Yeah.
It was so distracting to me. I was more comfortable pulling focus without a monitor. And that shot that I mentioned, where I literally had 17 marks from the moment the director said action to the moment the director said cut, I did not have a monitor.
Right.
It was all by eye and with the help of my second AC.
Yeah, it can be confusing, like, especially when I'm on longer term film projects, then going back to a digital job where you're kind of trying to use the monitor more, it's a whole extra thing you have to look at. Even if it's a little bit easier for some moments, it's kind of distracting once you're used to just marks, looking at talent, looking at your hand unit, or even manual focus. It kind of can mess with your head, I feel like, when you switch back and forth. McKay, I see your hand up.
Hey, yeah. So I've got another, it's not really an etiquette question, but I was wondering, David, what your thoughts on saying no to a DP, like what your thoughts on that are. I've encountered a couple of situations in my super short career where either, and I've sort of thought that the DPs who usually ask things like this were people who did not, climb the ladder. They kind of just started being a DP and had found success with that, and then would ask ACs to do things that. I feel like I've been asked to do some things that either I thought were unsafe, not well considered, or and then sometimes, like, this isn't something that I've encountered very much, but questions about, like, oh, can you maybe a producer or a DP would come in and hand you a piece of gear that is not. That's either like old or very poor quality. We like to say jank these days. Well, like, I mean, some type of like, oh, here, use this. This is what I use all the time. And I'm wondering if you've ever been in those situations what's the priority, especially if you're a first AC? Are you prioritizing, I need things to work the way that I want them to work because I'm running the camera team, or do you always defer to the DP and make their, I'm just kind of wondering what your thoughts are.
I've actually been in that situation where we've used the DP's camera and the matte box was a little funky. I would just explain, if you know, these filters, these diopters, whatever they may be, will not work in your matte box. So it's going to take me a few extra minutes to jury rig something, but I'll give you what you want as long as you allow me the time to do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if it's something like that, for the benefit of the shot, then yes, I would do it. But explain that, you know, your matte box takes X size filter. This is a Y size filter. It won't fit. I got to tape it on. I've got to do something. So your camera's safe, so the filters are safe, and so on. You know, just explain what you're doing. But if it's for the benefit of the shot, I would always defer to the DP. You know, I've heard of some people, you know, they've worked on some projects. There's some questionable material storylines that maybe go against their morals or their religious views or whatever, and they've refused to do the shot, which, again, that's up to the individual. So I hope that helps.
It does. Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah. I've also always found that, like, whether it's speaking up about safety sometimes actually is an exception to this rule, but in-person conversations, like one-on-one, tend to be really effective. So rather than maybe confronting somebody in front of the whole set, hey, your gear sucks, like this isn't working, or, you know, saying things in earshot of everybody, picking the right time and place to bring something up, like, hey, you know, we're having a lot of trouble with this, that's why it's taking extra time, just wanted to let you know. That kind of a conversation with that kind of tone is a lot more effective and professional than maybe openly complaining on a set or kind of not having as productive a focus to the conversation. So that's one thing I've found.
Always have a private conversation.
Yeah.
Whether it's about the equipment or about a problem within the department or whatever, you know, whenever possible, take the person off set.
Yeah. Let's see. I have a couple more questions from other viewers. Let's see. So Liz Stevens wanted to know about any set pranks through the years and any highlights you have from those.
Well, on the Wonder Years, I was on B camera. We had two cameras going most of the time. I was on B camera, and every once in a while, it depends. You have to know when is the right time to pull the pranks, okay? The operator, we were setting up a shot, and the operator's looking through the viewfinder, and he's like checking the f-stop, looking at the front of the camera to see if there's a lens cover on it, because he couldn't see through the eyepiece. Checking to make sure the shutter was clear, everything. And he couldn't figure out why he couldn't see through the eyepiece. And I reached behind the eyepiece and I reached in, I grabbed an Oreo cookie that I had put in there and I ate it. So, you know,
that must have tripped him out for a minute.
Yeah, he looked at me and said, you have any for me? So I had to go back to craft services. But yeah, that's one little silly thing. But again, you have to know when to do it. I saw a grip almost get fired for a little prank on set because he clipped the main actress with about a dozen C-47s just before she was about to do a shot.
Wow.
Oh,
very film
school. The director got so...
Talent, I try not to look them in the eye in general. Some of them are very nice, but like you got to know who to mess with and who not to.
Here's one that wasn't really a prank, but it was something that happened to me. I was doing an industrial film, did a lot of those, 16 millimeter, Arri SR3 on a dolly. I'm sitting on the dolly next to the operator, DP, and I've got my arm on the focus knob, my hand on the focus knob. All right. And we're doing the shot. From behind me, I see this hand come like across my peripheral vision and grab my arm and move it out of the way while I'm turning the focus knob, focusing the shot. I turn around, it was the still photographer.
The director, the DP yells cut. He looks at me, goes, what the F happened? And I just kind of pointed to the still photographer. And he tried to make some excuse up, and he went out into another room. So I followed him. And I just walked up to him, and I very calmly, because I don't get really angry too often, really hot. I just, all right, this is, I looked at him and I said, you ever touch me again, it will be the last person you touch.
Ooh.
And I walked back on set. And all of the grips and all of the electrics saw him do this. And the sound department. So every time he set up to do a still shot for the production, a grip would walk by with a C-stand, or a lighting guy would set up a light, or the boom operator would stick the boom. Nobody would let him get a shot after that. He finally went home after about an hour.
There you go. He
said to me, he said, well, I thought it was a rehearsal, you know, so.
Yikes.
You know, those are the kind of things, that doesn't happen very often, but that was probably one of the weirdest things that ever happened to me.
Yeah.
From another crew member.
If someone distracted me to that level during a take, I would assume it was like a safety reason. So that would I would probably listen to what they were saying, because usually people have a sense about when it's okay to interrupt and when it's not. It's a very bizarre story. That's a good one though. Yeah, very,
pranks,
very weird.
Pranks. I'm trying to think.
I know there are legends about lots of things that you can send your camera PA to go get.
Everybody wants you to go to the production office and get a jar of perfs.
Oh, that's a good one.
Can of F-stops.
Yeah.
And when I always ask for perfs, I would always say, now make sure it's Kodak perfs, because we're not using Fujifilm. We're using Kodak film.
There you go.
And the perfs are the different size. I had one PA going back and forth. Finally, the production coordinator called me on the phone and said, David, could you please give this guy a break and give me a break and stop doing this? Or sending, here's the fun one. Send them to the truck to get a piece of equipment that does not exist anywhere in the world. Make up a name. The grips always used to say, go get me a C-stand base extension. There's no such thing as a C-stand base extension.
I've heard HMI fluid is a solid
for
electric side.
You gotta have it. But make sure it's for the 12K HMI and not the 6K, because they use the different viscosity fluid. I know one gaffer who asked a brand new electric to go to the truck and get the fallopian tubes.
That's a great one.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, because everything, and especially when you're green, just starting out, everything has a strange name on the camera and the grip truck. So a lot of these things don't sound that out of place.
No, but
I love the tradition. As far as as long as it's the right time and the place, I think it's pretty funny. It can be a great way to welcome someone to the department.
You like I said, we're gonna have fun tonight. You gotta have fun on set, but you have to know when is the right time.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, cool. Let me see. I had one good question that might be on a different topic. This one's interesting. So it's getting a bit more into the networking / how to get hired on the next job side. I guess personally, I've learned recently within the last couple of years that when a producer calls me, the interview really is going both ways. Kind of learning that you're basically interviewing a potential job just as much as they're interviewing you. And you want to make sure that it's a good opportunity, that the rates are correct, that it's not a surprise overnight or a crazy deal, So I'm wondering what kind of questions you would kind of ask once you got a phone call for a job, especially if it was with a DP or producer you hadn't worked with before.
Okay. That's great. There's a whole section in the book, a chapter called Before, During, and After the Job.
Yeah.
And in the section before the job, that's when you're going to get interviewed. There's a whole checklist of questions, and they're in no particular order of importance. And I'm sure that some of you can come up with additional questions. And if you do have any additional questions, send them to me, because they might appear in the next edition if I decide to do a new edition. All right, what format? Is it 60 millimeter? Is it 35 millimeter? Is it digital? That's important. And second to that is what camera? You know, what camera am I? Do I know the camera? I got hired, one of the first jobs I got hired on for Second AC was using the Panavision 16, what we commonly refer to as the Elaine.
Right.
I had never seen it. But when the first AC interviewed me over the phone, I was like, oh yeah, sure, no problem. I know how to load that. And the next day I went over to Panavision and said, hey guys, can you show me this camera? I've got a job coming up next week and I've never seen it before. And they showed me and everything was fine. And the first AC never knew otherwise. Yeah. So what camera are you gonna use? If they haven't told you to begin with, and you don't know, is it a union or non-union? Because that's gonna depend on your rate. The union sets your rate if it's a union job. And if you're not union, then you've got to determine what your rate's going to be. And the next one goes to that. What is the rate? You know, producer, what do you want to pay me? They'll always come back with, what's your rate?
Yeah. That back and forth is always fun.
What's in your budget? You know, and we'll go back and forth four or five questions before we'll get it worked out.
I love when often hiring happens over text for me, and they'll send me the initial text, often with a lot of important information lacking. Then I'll say, hey, thanks so much. Here's a list of questions. When they answer every single question except for anything to do with money, it can't be accidental. So it's always just an interesting dynamic to try to navigate, you know.
Producers are about the bottom line.
Yeah.
So, once you get the rate worked out, is it for 8 hours, 10 hours, 12 hours? Know how many hours that rate applies for.
Yeah, okay. Super, super important.
Is this a flat rate or is there overtime?
Which flat rates are illegal. Not to say you won't still get offers for them, but if someone comes at you.
Don't ever take a job for a flat rate.
Yeah.
Is there anybody online right now that does not know what a flat rate is? Raise your hand. Okay, I don't see any hands going up.
Yeah, I mean, it's not rocket science. It's just basically if you hit 10 hours or 12 hours, they're not going to pay you any overtime or any, you know, which is illegal. Like by national labor law, every state labor law, you have to define how many hours the pay is for so that you can budget it out into hourly, and then one and a half times after 8 hours often, and then double time once you hit 12 hours. Depends on the state, but it's a solid red flag and a mark of a shady production company if they want to book you for, you know, whatever it is, $500 for flat without giving you any option for like overtime. Yeah.
You can do a 24-hour day and it's still $500.
Yeah. Super illegal and super dangerous. So it's just, yeah. It's a good earmark of a production company that takes itself seriously and is going to respect you if they already have thought through, you know, a decent hourly rate and they're not expecting to, you know, be shady or cut corners.
How often will I be paid? Am I going to fill out a time card and get paid weekly? Am I going to invoice after the job and get paid 30 days after I submit the invoice? What is your policy for paying? And if you do submit an invoice, make sure your invoice says somewhere on it, you know, payment expected within 30 days of date of invoice. After that, you know, X number of percent per day interest charge. I can't remember what it is, but I have a custom blank invoice that you can use. It's on the website for the companion side of the book, CameraAssistantManual.com. All of my forms from the book are on that website for anybody to use free of charge. So, and I've got that statement on there. Usually
If they don't pay you within 30 days, if you send them a new invoice with a little bit more money added, it usually gets their attention. Does the rate include prep days and wrap days? I was surprised how often productions didn't want to pay me a prep day.
That's still a huge problem. Even for film jobs, which you would think people would know you need to prep that, but it's a constant battle.
It's going to take, 8 hours to prep the camera, but they still only want to pay you a half day prep. Well, I'm taken out of the job market for the whole day. I should get a whole day's prep.
Right.
Some companies don't do that. And some don't pay a wrap day. Just like you got to prepare the equipment to get it onto the production, you've got to prepare it to send it back to the rental house. So when the rental house, my feeling is the equipment should go back to the rental house looking better than it did when you received it.
Amen to that, yeah.
The camera, all the accessories, everything. Remove all tape marks, everything that you've done, clean it up so it goes back because it's your reputation.
You know, this actually reminds me of something. It's kind of random. I haven't heard of other ACs doing this, but I started doing it. Once in a while, I would be on a bit of a crap shoot and they either wouldn't give me enough time to wrap everything perfectly, or maybe it was a desert shoot and I knew there was like some dust in the outside of the Pelican, something where I knew it wasn't ideal in the condition that I would send it back. Maybe I took the cage apart a little bit and I wasn't able to fully reconstruct it. So I just went to Starbucks and bought a bunch of $5 to $10 gift cards that I would just keep in my wallet. And yes, it's coming out of my personal pocket, but if there's a case that I feel like, hey, you know what, this is a little bit messier than I received it, I'll stick the Starbucks gift card in, write a quick note on a piece of gaff tape to the prep tech and just be like, hey, so sorry, this is a bit, disassembled. Here's a coffee on me to make up for it. And just try to make it so that when they think about my name, they think about like the latte they just treated themselves to, as opposed to, maybe like there's something not perfect about the case. It's not something that's required and it's not something is industry standard, but it's just like everyone can find their own ways of like just making sure your reputation is protected and like that you're networking and making good relationships with the rental houses because they're the ones that will have your back.
If the equipment comes back and it's all messed up, they're not going to go to the producer. They're not going to go to the director. They're not going to go to the production company or the studio. They're going to go to the first AC.
Yeah.
And it's your reputation. And the next time you're using that rental house and you need a favor, hey, the company I'm working for doesn't have a lot of money in the budget, but I need XYZ accessory. They'll throw it in.
Yeah.
If you have treated their equipment nicely.
It's so true. Because they want you to do a good job. Like in theory, they want their gear to be exactly what you need to do the job effectively. So as long as you go like a slight extra mile and make sure that you're taking care of their gear, that's all they care about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is there a box or kit rental? I understand that's hard to get nowadays too.
Yeah. Often even when it's budgeted for, I get the sense that if I hadn't asked, they just never would have brought it up. Even on like high budget commercials where it's like, oh yeah, it's 50 a day for, your kit, not even gear. It seems like if you don't remember to ask it, they will just kind of let it slide.
I've got some equipment of my own. Would you be willing to rent it from me? I know filters or batteries or various other things that ACs have. Is this local or distant? Is it a local shoot, or are we going to be traveling, beyond the 30-mile zone or even, further? If it's a distant location, do you pay travel expenses, per diem, lodging, food, et cetera?
Mm-hmm.
How many weeks do you anticipate shooting? I have another job coming up that I booked at the end of November. I want to make sure that I can still take it. And because if they say 6 weeks, the production's going to go 8. Something's going to go wrong.
Yeah.
Do you plan on working 5 or 6 days a week? Some productions, if they're local in the Hollywood area, they usually have to keep it to 5 days a week for the actors. But beyond,
that sometimes they you know, they'll go 6 days. Don't go seven, please. Don't work a 7 day week. You kill yourself. I always ask this, even though they never tell you the truth. How many days, excuse me, how many hours per day do you anticipate shooting? They're always going to say, oh, 12, less than 12. No worries, you know. And then 16 hours later, you're still on set. But I ask it anyway. If we go longer than 14 hours on a distant location, will you provide lodging so people don't have to drive home tired? I think of Brent Hirschman. No. What are the scheduled start and end dates of the production? So, again, you know, we have other jobs that we're booking. You have to know. And for my friends, are there any other crew positions available? I've got a couple people that are grips or electrics that, you know, are looking. If you need some, I can give you names. And what is your policy for cancellation? Do you pay any cancellation fee? Most productions, as far as I know, don't do that.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever had it written into like a pay or play clause. It's
I got a cancellation fee once.
Wow.
And it just threw me. I was like, what? What is that?
Yeah.
I didn't even know what it was when he said, well, you know. And it was, I always joke about this job because I lost the same job 12 times. They kept starting and having the money, but then they didn't have the money. But then some producers fell out, so we got to get new producers. There was an excuse every other week. And it turned out that it went up for like 12 different times. I had the job, then I didn't have the job. I had the job, then I didn't have the job. And by the time they actually made the movie, they had eliminated my position. So I never did the film.
It sounds like maybe you weren't missing out on much based on that organization.
It was a classic motion picture called Lobster Man from Mars.
Oh, that's my favorite movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And if you are the operator or the DP, I always ask, can I get copies of footage for my reel?
Hmm. No. Yeah, that could be hard to track down, I imagine. Yeah.
A lot of the footage that I currently have on my reel, I had to pull it from VHS tapes or DVDs. I couldn't get it from the production company. So
yeah,
those are the questions I have. If you, like I said, if you have any others, I would love to add them.
Yeah, I think the only one that sticks out to me that I usually ask is just especially if it's a longer project, how many overnights or splits do you see happening? They're going to lie to you. Like, they're going to add some, but like if it's called like, you know, Night of the Walking Zombies, then like probably it's going to be a lot of night shoots. Like horror movies especially tend to be brutal. And I mean, it may even be more important with commercials or shorts, because if I'm going to flip my entire schedule to be overnights for a 3 day short, it's probably not worth it to me, or it's at least like the rate should be a lot higher. It's a consideration because it might cut into like the day after. I can't necessarily take work on a Tuesday if I'm working till 4 a.m. on Monday. So that's a good one I try to ask. And because I'd been burned by that, by not asking that a couple times, so I kind of learned that lesson. The super comprehensive list, though, really helpful, I think. I guess nowadays, COVID, because that's still a thing, just asking what the not only what the precautions are going to be like on set, but also what the testing schedule is like. Often they're going to ask you to be available the day before they actually book you for testing. Sometimes there's not a stipend. Sometimes there is. There always should be, but it's an important thing to bring up, whether it's a couple $100 or, you know, testing on site, that kind of thing.
What are your COVID protocols?
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. I forgot about that one.
It's such a mixed bag. Some sets don't even enforce masks and continue to shoot all through COVID, mainly looking at music videos for that. But and then some shoots you're, you know, zoned really specifically and you're not able to leave the area where you're in with your department. They're really careful. So it definitely can change a lot depending on the shoot. Yeah. And I think okay. Matt may have made a comment that it with union has, yeah. So union has protocols about how much you make for COVID tests. Non-union is a lot more of a Wild West for that. So you still have to ask. Let's see. Do we have any other questions in the folks who are currently here? Can have some
there's
time.
A lot
for...
There's a lot of names in front of my screen and I haven't heard from most of you.
Let me see if I have any more on the list, but we're definitely
getting
down. Just
here to enjoy the show. I don't know.
Matt, do we have any questions that came up in the chat? I haven't been monitoring it super well.
Besides McKay asking about ghost stories? No.
All right. Bethany, what have you got?
Just going back to the rate stuff for a quick second. I find more times than not, I'm asked my rate and not necessarily offered a rate. And I'm curious if you should ever give that answer, if you should kind of feel out what their budget is before you say anything.
I personally always try to feel them out and see what they're going to say. But then if they're so tight-lipped, I'll find and give them a number. It's usually a little bit higher than my rate, just so I can judge by their reaction. And then you know, they go, well, I don't know if I can afford. Then, you know, then I will always clarify and say, look, I'm willing to negotiate. What are you willing to pay? You know, and if it's too low, I just won't take the job.
Sure.
You know, again, and that's what's too low for me might not be too low for you or somebody else. So it's again, goes back to, it's up to the individual, you know. I do have contrary to what I said earlier, I do have standards, and there is a bottom level of low that I won't go below. And again, it comes back to the project, the people working on it, do I know them, the DP, and so on. So.
For sure. Thank you so much.
Yeah, that makes total sense. Question from Matt Coons. He wants to know, did you find any artistic fulfillment through being a part of the camera team? And was that relegated to when you were working as an operator, or did you also find kind of fulfillment as a first AC, second AC, loader, et cetera?
Basically, everything I worked on, I felt that.
Huh.
It may sound silly, but especially the some things that the story was really good. It was a good story. I felt like as a focus puller, you know, hey, if you can't see the picture, you don't know what the story's about. And as an operator, if it's not framed. So yeah, a lot of things I felt some artistic pride in because of just what they were. I mean, the Wonder Years, especially, because that was they're doing a whole new remake of it.
Are they really?
Yeah, it's coming out September 22nd.
Oh, wow. And that was your basically career goal to work on, right? I remember that from last time.
It wasn't necessarily a career goal. It was just when they first started producing it, it became a goal at that time.
Sure.
To work on, because I thought it was such high quality television, and we don't get much of that. Then and now. That was back in the 80s. And of course, when they first called me to work on it, I turned them down because I was already on another job.
Yeah.
But it depends on what the project is, I guess I'll say it. So I did feel that about certain projects, again, because of the quality, the story. It always comes back to the story. If it's a good story and it has a message and it moves, if it's going to make somebody think or feel something, then yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I feel like that's super relatable. And that makes a lot of sense to me.
You know,
it's cool.
If I'm just doing a stupid commercial for orange juice, who cares? You know,
yeah.
Still, I want it to look good.
Yeah. It's fun to see how those things get made and like the kind of, I appreciate even just watching art department on some of those things and kind of seeing how all those creative people come together. Because like you don't get to experience that when you watch the orange juice commercial on TV, but kind of seeing how much heart and soul gets actually poured into those is kind of cool. And sometimes it's soul crushing and boring if it's that, you know, corporate commercial vibe. It just depends on the shoot. I definitely feel. Let's see. So there were a couple questions we didn't get to that I can kind of lump into one relating to film and kind of if you're trying to transition into more film work or get more familiar with that. Thomas Holmes asked about how to approach prepping a film package and what considerations you might want to have if you're more used to the digital world or kind of trying to transition. And Ada Wasilowska had some questions about how to stay organized on longer term film jobs. And how to make sure, because of the extra workflow, paperwork, short ends, all that kind of stuff.
Well, let's start with the prepping. Prepping anything, prepping film or digital or anything, you be organized. You have to be organized. Have a checklist. I feel that I have a pretty good checklist in the book.
Mm-hmm.
The ASC manual, I don't know, the American Cinematographer manual. If you're not familiar with it, it's.
Yeah.
Has a really good, has two separate prep checklists, one for film and one for digital. Mine is an all-inclusive. It's got digital stuff and film stuff interspersed. But have a checklist and follow that checklist because every single camera package you prep is going to be different than the one you just prepped the last show. And it's going to be different than the one you're going to prep for the next show. There's not, rarely is there going to be two camera packages that are going to be identical. So have a checklist, be willing to modify that checklist, and have a system and stick to the system. Like I prepped, when I prepped, I would get do all the magazines. I would check, scratch test all the magazines first, get them out of the way. Then I would check the accessories and all the little stuff and the cables. And the last thing I would usually do on my preps is the lenses because they take the longest time.
That's fair. Yeah.
And then other ACs I know would do just the opposite. So it's not that my way is the right way. It's just being organized. I always told my students, develop a system that works for you and stick with it.
Yeah, that's great advice. I've heard for preps, and I don't even really follow this advice, so whatever, but kind of starting with the things that'll take the longest to fix if there's something wrong with them. So in theory, I guess starting with lenses and checking all the lenses before you even make lens markings makes sense. I just sometimes find it doesn't fit with the flow of how I prep, but just at least considering that, like what are the main building blocks of the camera package? What do I need to make sure is okay? What isn't replaceable? So we need to make sure it's functional.
And don't let anybody from the production office rush you on your prep.
True.
And the last thing you want to do is you don't want to take a job where they say, oh, yeah, we don't have time for a prep, so the camera will be here when you arrive on the first day.
Oof. Yeah. Hard pass. You
know, I probably wouldn't take that job, but I do have a form online, which is called a non-prep disclosure, which basically says that I will not be held responsible for any equipment that I did not have the opportunity to check beforehand. And I make somebody from production sign it.
Yeah.
If they won't sign it, then I don't do the job. I never had that. Even with small independent stuff with the DP's camera, I usually got a chance to check the camera beforehand,
mm-hmm.
which was not an issue.
Yeah. So. Yeah, I guess with a film prep, kind of what you're saying, if you have a background in digital preps, it's the same idea, and there's not really that many differences, but film gear is especially difficult to fix and source nowadays. So if there is something wrong with like the camera body, it's kind of a big ordeal to maybe get it shipped in from another rental house. It's not like they're going to have 10 identical bodies on the shelf. So I guess just prioritizing what you're checking, maybe start with the film specific stuff, the mags and the body, and the 16 glass, because that's, you know, kind of specific. And yeah, all that is really good advice about not, about basically like holding up your department, you know, even as soon as the prep. You just have to be advocating for the time you need, the resources. And that's always a good way to go. Yeah.
What cool. was the other part of this question was about
I think you basically covered both, but staying organized,
well,
on
something
jobs.
about
yeah, with short ends and paperwork, well, how to
being,
long
being organized. Yeah, being organized on set, just I'm sorry to use the same words, but just be organized, you know. Have your carts, have your lens cart, have your mag cart, have your accessory cart, if you want to do it that way. But, you know, have a system and stick with the system. You know, every AC should have at least one cart these days, if not more, so you can move the equipment from room to room, location to location. You don't want to be carrying this stuff all day because you've got enough to do, enough to worry about. Have a system. Know where your equipment is at all times. If you can, bring on a camera PA or a camera trainee that is willing to learn. And, you know, you are in charge of making sure that this equipment is always 10 feet away from the camera department. Don't get it in the shot. Don't get it in the way of anybody else. Don't park it on the dolly track. But make sure it's there if we need it. You know,
Well,
don't bring things onto the set from the truck that you do not need.
That's a tough one. Just bringing everything you need, but nothing more. Take some experience, but when you kind of master that skill, it's really helpful. Speaking of film jobs and camera PAs, I see Olivia has her hand up. How's it going?
Good. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hi, Olivia.
Hi. I have a question. So what are the best qualities to have an assistant that make you indispensable to like a DP or just the camera department in general?
The best qualities of an assistant that make you indispensable is to have a positive attitude, always be able and willing to anticipate what I'm going to need before I ask for it. And you do that by just paying attention. I always tell my assistants, keep your eyes and ears open at all times. And especially in this day and age, if you're sitting there looking at this all the time, then I don't want you. You know, you've got to be ready to do the job. If I need a lens, if I need a filter, if I need be ready to get, have it in your hand before I ask for it. That may sound silly, but if you're paying attention, a lot of times you can do that. A lot of times the DP and the director will use the same lens for close-up, or the same lens for a two-shot, or the same filter when they're doing a close-up of a particular actress. And if you know that that's the shot that's coming up, then get that filter out of the box and ready to hand it off, or get that lens up. So anticipation is the key. But most important, and I said this earlier this evening, is to always have a good attitude. If you had some issues or troubles at home, leave them at home. Nobody on set wants to hear about it. Because again, we're there together for a long time, every day, 12 hours or more. But just always be willing to jump in at a moment's notice and do whatever is necessary within your department. You know, don't be a know-it-all. Don't pretend you know everything. Because there's nobody on this screen right now, including me, that knows everything. And I don't pretend to. When people are working, keep the chatter and the unnecessary talk to a minimum. Things like that, just common sense, really. You'll learn as you work with different DPs what is good and what isn't good. But the biggest thing, again, is the best attitude. And always, always show up at least a half hour early. Because if you're on time, you're late.
That help? Okay.
Awesome.
I wanted to,
great advice.
Caitlin, I wanted to mention, somebody asked something about short ends.
Yeah, let me just check the question, but I think it was just in general on a long-term film shoot, how do you account for all the short ends, make sure you're not getting disorganized, that kind of thing.
I have in the book and on the companion website, it's called, can you all see that short end inventory form, right? This is a form I created. And it, you just can keep track of when it was used, how much was used, and so on. It's just a basic inventory sheet for short ends. You know, if you don't like this one, make your own.
Yeah.
So that's the best way. That's the best way.
If a short end is, this is random, but if a short end is shot in the same day, so if you short end it in the morning and then you shoot it in the afternoon, do you account for that, or is it just kind of?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll have to take a look at that because we had made our own spreadsheet for the last show and had a little bit of trouble with that aspect of it.
I would. I mean, I have a space here for date created and a space here for date used. So they may be the same.
Yeah, okay.
You know? So
that makes total sense.
You create a short end in the morning, and then later on in the day, you discover there's a shot you need to get with that same stock, and all you have is the short end, and you're going to use it. You didn't plan on it. And so, yeah, I would say yes.
Yeah, just at least have it written down. That makes sense. It's always a good feeling to end a show, especially a longer one, with like hardly any short ends. So that's kind of the goal, to be able to use it all. Yeah, yeah. Cool. Matt, did we have any questions in the chat? I thought I saw one.
Yes.
Cool.
We do. So I'm going to butcher this person's name, and I feel super bad, but it's either Maha or Maja. And the question is for David. Did your career get a significant boost from the release of the book? Has the book affected your life in any other way? Any doors opened? Surprising new networking possibilities? You know, in what way did the book impact your life that you didn't expect?
Well, more people know who I am when I go to industry-related functions. Before the book, it was just, hi, I'm Dave Elkins. Oh, nice to meet you, Dave. What do you do? Not now, but after the book came out, hi, I'm Dave Elkins. You're the Dave Elkins? You know, maybe it helped my career and got more jobs. I don't know. I just kept working. It just continued. And I had the book under my belt, and I could, you know, people could say, you know, like all of you folks, thank you for writing the book. You know, I want to show everybody, compared to the 7th edition, what the 1st edition looks like. That's how thin it is compared to the 7th edition. This is 522 pages. This one is 125. So it's grown a little bit over the 20 some years or 30 some years since I first wrote it. And I didn't write it for any kind of fame or glory. I wrote it to help beginners who wanted to learn how to do the job because there was nobody else and no other book out there. And I can't tell you how many people, I don't want to say threatened me, but were very angry at me for writing the book and giving away all the secrets of the camera department. I got a lot of people who criticized me and put me down and whatever because I was, I don't know, selling out or whatever by sharing this information with the rest of the world. And all I wanted to do was help, you know, beginners who had no other way. You know, this was before when I wrote this, there weren't all the film schools and training centers and workshops like there are now. Like I said, I learned by doing on the job. Now people like yourselves have a source to at least learn the basics and go out there and start working. So maybe it helped me get more jobs. I don't know.
Yeah, it bothers me when people hold information like it's too precious to share.
Sacred.
Like, I don't think it is, because I mean that's the kind of mentality that will make film go extinct with one generation. But same thing with all the skills, anything that's valued, like you have to be able to pass it along. I feel like it should be easy to access the information. It's not like that's all it takes to be an AC. You have to commit and learn it yourself. So it's not like you've taken the work out of it for people, you know? They still have to be able to take ownership. But yeah, I don't understand the mentality that would resent that. Yeah.
It didn't stop me, as
no.
you can see.
That's for sure. Yeah. Yeah. Matthew, what else we got?
I've got another one that is from Patrick, who is asking about day playing. Any tips for day players or coming onto a production in progress? I often find it difficult to come on when the main crew have been working for so long within their system and needing to learn it quickly to, you know, not break up their workflow.
I've done a lot of day playing, and I guess I'll say if you know how to do the job, and you must know how to do the job if you've been hired, learning a new system is not going to be that difficult, I don't think. Everybody may have a slightly different way of doing things, but the basic fundamentals are going to be the same. You know, they may keep different cases in a different spot on the camera truck, and they, you know, they may want you to slate a certain way or hand off a lens or filter a certain way, but you can catch on to that immediately. You know, if you're able to do that, day playing is just like you're on another show. It's not a big deal to me. I mean, I never had an issue. You know, I always start out, introduce myself, ask them how they want me. How do you want me to do things? What do you want me to do? Okay. I'm here to help you guys. I'm here as a first AC on the B camera. Is there specific protocols? Let me know. I get that. I try to cover that right at the beginning, and the rest of it's easy.
Yeah, that's great advice. I found that, like, kind of just over communicating a little bit when I'm day playing usually makes up for any lack of, you know, familiarity with how they're doing things. And usually people are really nice and welcoming because they know that, you know, I'm new to the set, whatever. It's a little nerve wracking though. You're coming on to like the middle of a crew with like all their inside jokes figured out. They already know how to get the coffee first. You know, just all the stuff that you would have learned over the last 15 days, they've already kind of have down pat. But yeah, usually it's nice. You can just find someone to kind of take you under their wing or yeah, try to sit with people at lunch because that's, you know, a great way to kind of get to know them in a more casual way. Also, I guess I would just end up being super early when I'm day playing, which does cut into my turnaround. But like, at least if I'm there when they're all getting breakfast in the morning, it's a chance to like meet everybody, at least put names to faces, just like you do on any set, but kind of more so when you're the new kid.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's great advice. Matthew, do we have one more or do we already catch it?
Frank wanted to say thank you, which we all thank David very, very much. And I do have another one. It's about being a green second assistant. And if you have any recommendations for tips of like things to do at home to improve skill sets, right? But for the second AC as opposed to the first, you know, and in particular becoming more technically proficient, you know, like how does one study gear in order to have a higher technical proficiency to become a better second assistant?
Well, if you can, like I did when I got that job with the Panavision Elaine, I called Panavision, explained the situation. They said, sure, come on out. We'll show you the camera. So if you don't have access to a camera or the equipment, but you know which camera, which model you're going to use, that's what I would do, is I would call the rental house first and say, hey, I'm doing it. I just got hired as a second AC. I'm fresh out of film school, or I'm green, or whatever the terminology you want to use. You know, I haven't done this before, but I want to do a really good job. And I know we're getting, you should always try to go to the rental house that they're going to rent the camera from, because they're going to be more inclined to help you. But, you know, can I come out, and can somebody show me at your convenience, you know, how the camera works, what I need to know, some tricks, whether it's film or digital, you know. And most rental houses, if they're really a reputable rental house, will say, sure, you know, can you come out Wednesday at 3 o'clock, and we'll have a guy work with you, or gal work with you, and show you how to do this, how to thread the magazines, how to set the menu settings, if that's the case, and so on. But do not just walk into the rental house and go, hi, I'm here, show me the SR3, you know. They'll show you the door. Yeah.
Especially on a Monday or a Friday. You got to be like respectful of when they're going to be busy. And especially COVID, a lot of them are not super thrilled to have random folks in there. And, you know, normally they might be okay with it, but yeah, that's great rule of thumb.
And if that doesn't work out, just show up real early on the first day. Try to see if the first AC will show up a little earlier, and they can go over as much as necessary to start out with. And then as the day progresses, they can go over more and more. And, you know, in a short time, you will learn all you need to know.
Yeah, super true. I think we have time for about one more question. McKay, you wanna give us yours?
So it's actually not a question. It's just something that I've learned while second ACing a lot. That I think helps to answer the last question. I started realizing, I'm like, wow, I feel like the shoots that I was at the prep have been significantly better than the ones where I was not at the prep as a second AC. And I kept going like, well, wow, I guess I just need to ask, I need to negotiate to get, you know, try and get paid to get on that prep so that I can, you know, because whenever I'm there, then I can see the equipment, I can get to know the first a little bit. And then I started to realize another thing about first ACs, which I think is kind of true, is that they're I feel like either, you know, a little bit timid or a little bit proud. So I would text them and be like, hey, you know, is there anything, like, do you need me to stop by? Like, is there any way I can help? And they're like, no way, for sure. You know, if you're not getting paid, it's okay. Like, well, I'll totally be able to handle the prep by myself. But as far as, you know, just an answer to feeling green, the thing that I've always done, and a rule that I've made for myself, is it's great to be paid to get on the prep as a second. It's preferred. But if I'm not, I just, you know, whoever hired me for the job with the, just say, hey, I'll stop by. And they're not going to tell you not to. And you can go there, and it's a time, especially if it's with the first AC you've never worked with before. I mean, people really like to talk about the stuff that they're doing, or just being there. And then you can have a familiarity of what, you know, the different, like, where the equipment is, and where it's going to be in the cases, what's in the AKS. So I always, you know, even if I'm not getting paid for it, I always try and stop by the prep. It's a good rule of thumb for me.
That's definitely a good thing, you know. Yeah. I always had my second come on the prep, whether he or she was getting paid or not. And most of them were willing to do it. And once in a while, I was lucky, I was able to negotiate a little bit of pay for them. And sometimes I would actually pay them out of my pocket, out of my prep day, just so they, you know, they could see the equipment. But that's a good thing to do, is to try to go to the prep. You know, it's only going to help you in your career, whatever you do. So
yeah, super true.
I've got one last one. let's try and sneak in here, if we don't mind, David.
Oh, I'm available all night, whatever you want.
We appreciate you.
We can go past 9 o'clock if you want.
We very much appreciate you. So the question, you had kind of touched on this a little bit earlier. It was about working as a loader and a second, a film loader and a second simultaneously. And so do you have any other tips for newer film loaders who haven't developed many second AC skills about prioritization on set, right? When you come in and you mostly know the film loader job, how do you know how to juggle the two positions at once?
Well, you should have a basic understanding of the second AC responsibilities, putting marks down for the actors, slating, keeping camera reports, getting equipment for the first AC. So you should at least understand what that's about. And the more you do it, the better you're going to get at it. When you're working as the loader and the second, obviously, you know, there's going to be times where you're going to have to leave set to load the film. You do not just up and leave. You always talk to the first AC, and hopefully you've got more than two or three magazines. So you're never going to run out of magazines loaded with film. And I'm talking film here. You always go to the first AC and say, hey, look, I've got three shot mags that need to be downloaded and reloaded. Is there going to be a good time coming up soon where I can do that? And based on where we are in the shoot day and so on, they'll know that after we get this next take, we're going to do a whole big turnaround and relight. And that's a perfect time for the second AC to go to the truck or wherever they're doing their loading process. And usually they go, they get it done and come back and everything is fine. Once in a while, my second had to leave set. I always say, leave me the slate, leave me the clipboard with the camera reports. So just in case we go a little bit faster than you, I can slate the shot. I can do the camera report, or somebody else can do it while you're gone. But always work it out so the first AC always knows where you are and what you're doing. Because otherwise they'll be in a panic looking for you. You have to know how to do the job. Putting a piece of tape on the floor is easy. Once you've done it once, everybody knows, you should know how to put a mark down. Clapping a slate, you should know how to do that. You practice a few times. Knowing how to fill out a camera report. And the rest, you know, again, it's all common sense. But just work it out among yourself. Communication is the key. Communication between the first and the second, between the second and the camera PA, if there is one, and so on. Does that help? Yeah. All right, Matt. Thanks. What else?
Yeah. I think that's probably about it from the chat, unless I'm missing something, Matt.
No, to this point, Kevin did ask about resumes, and I posted a comment about select mm-hmm. work experience. You posted your resume.
Yeah.
There's kind of no right and wrong with that.
Agreed. Yeah. Yeah. It's really sometimes, I mean, have you guys ever been asked for a focus pulling reel? Like that's a real thing people will ask for.
Yeah.
No, I know it's ridiculous, but like people will ask. It's pretty.
Do you have a second AC reel? Your best slates?
Second AC? I don't know. I mean,
I've heard that though.
Funny. Yeah. Actually, I think someone made one. I'm not sure who, but
there's
as
a whole
like a
video
joke.
That's
yeah.
kind of this like behind the scenes joke of this
yeah.
guy like doing all these goofy slates and
yeah.
A first AC book. Let me see some of the. I'll show him my 17 focus mark shot. That what I'll show.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just such a ridiculous ask because even if I had a reel of shots I've successfully pulled on, they don't know, maybe it took me 20 tries and I barely, you know, got the 21st one. You know, it's not really a job that you can have a direct reel. It's mainly, you know, I guess I get recommended based on who knows me and who knows that I'm not, you know, faking my skills and stuff like that. But yeah, it is funny. It's a Wild West when it comes to, you know, what you get asked for as far as resumes or experience or, you know, interviewing.
Like I always say, every day on the job is a new adventure.
It is. Totally is. Okay. In good ways and bad ways, both.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well,
can I end it with a funny story?
Sure. Absolutely.
I think it's funny anyway. So, as Caitlin mentioned, I mentioned, I did the Wonder Years. I did Star Trek. I did music videos for Coolio, Cypress Hill, Red Hot Chili Peppers, Beastie Boys, just to name a few. And I got a call from a DP that I had worked with consistently for an industrial type job. And he said, the problem is the production manager wants to meet you and interview you. Because many of you know that if you get called for a job, it's like the DP says, yeah, my go-to guy is Matt, or my go-to gal is Caitlin, or Mindy, or Bethany, or whoever. And the production manager says, okay, hire him. But no, this guy wanted to meet me and interview me. So I said, okay, I'm fine with that. You know, he doesn't know me. So I go, I give him my resume. He's looking at my resume. Again, I've got some top award-winning television series on my resume that I pulled focus for. And he says to me, he kept asking me questions that you would ask a beginner, like, do you understand the importance of keeping an accurate inventory of your expendables? And do you know how to do an inventory of film stock and things like that? And yes, sir. Yes, I do. I've done that many times, sir. And I was trying to be professional and polite. And he just kept going back to the same really stupid questions. And I finally had it about up to here. And I said, excuse me, just a minute. And I reached into my briefcase and I pulled out the camera assistant manual. Did not say a word. And I opened it up to the section on how to fill out a film inventory form, because he kept asking me. And I handed it to him across the desk. And so he sits there and he's looking through the book and he's looking up at me and he's looking through and he looks up at me. And finally he looks up at me and he says, so you've read this? And I looked at him and very calmly said, no, sir, I wrote it. And he closed the cover and he went, oh, fuck, you've got the job. Excuse me.
I feel that. That would have been my exact response.
I apologize for the language.
No, that's an amazing flex. And that's totally worth it.
At the end of that production, he came up to me and he said, could I get a copy of your book? And I said, sure. $39.95, and I'll have it here tomorrow.
That's beautiful. That is an amazing story.
I haven't done that since, and I had not done it before. It was just, he had gotten to me. It was like, I did not just, nothing against any of you just starting out, but I didn't just start out. I know what I'm doing, you know?
Right. that's an amazing way to prove that. and perfect that you happen to have it in your bag.
So.
Well, thank you so much for spending the time in your evening to talk to all of us.
Thank you so much,
and,
David.
Yeah.
An absolute pleasure. It was a pleasure to meet all of you. Some of you, I don't know what you look like because only your names are in front of me, but that's okay. I think Matt posted or Caitlin posted my email. It's david@davidelkins.com. Feel free to email me questions anytime. I do respond. Yeah, there it is. There it is. So anything else?
Here, I just posted your email in the group chat. And I also shared the info for Matthew Borek and myself. If you have questions about, you know, the LA industry, joining the union, especially for Matthew, but you know, anything you guys want to reach out to us to, we're super approachable. And I know we can say the same thing about David. Thank you all for joining us. This has been really amazing.
Thanks for taking time out of your Friday.
Yeah, really appreciate it.
Come and play.
Yeah.
Hope you all have wonderful success in your careers, and maybe I'll meet you someday on set.
That sounds great. Thanks so much. Enjoy the rest of your evening, everyone.
Take care, everybody.
Thank you all so much.
My pleasure.